This is your math gal, Julie Harland. Please visit my website at yourmathgal.com, where all of my videos are organized by topic. This is part two of graphing trig functions. In part one, we did a sketch of y equals sine of x by making this table of values, which we got from the circular functions, the unit circle. And this is just a rough sketch. The domain, that means the values of x, was between negative infinity and infinity. The range, the y values, they went back and forth from negative 1 to positive 1. And then we've loosely defined that this had a period of 2 pi. In other words, before it started repeating itself, it went 2 pi units on the x-axis. Now, I've sort of compress this so you could see that, you know, this sine function, or sine wave as it's called, you know, has a lot of these little humps here going above and below and going through 0, 0, and then pi 0, and then 2 pi 0, and 3 pi 0, etc. So I'm not putting in a lot of values, and I'm just doing a rough sketch of this. Make sure that when you do it, use a pencil, and, you know, you kind of curve it. Don't make it look like it has any sharp edges at all. So what I have at the bottom here is the precise definition for a periodic function. A periodic function with period p is a function f such that f of x equals f of x plus p for every real number x in the domain of f, where p is the smallest number for which this is true. Man, that's hard to swallow and understand. But what it's saying here is if you put a number x and like the if the period is 2 pi, that means if I did f of x plus 2 pi, I would get the exact same value. And in this case, that's actually true, because if you have a real number and you add 2 pi to it and you're on that unit circle, you're going to end up in the exact same spot with the same value for your y-coordinate. All right, so that's sort of what this means, but looking at it, you get a better idea. So if you start somewhere and you just pick a place to start and think, where, how long is it before it starts repeating itself? I might say, okay, let's say I started right here at 0, 0, that's a nice place, and I see it's going up and down and up, and then it starts repeating itself. So how big is that space? Well, it goes from 0 to 2 pi. And that's where we get the idea that the period is 2 pi. Now, somebody else may have not started right there. They said, well, how about is if I start like over here, a little to the left of the 0, 0, which is right here. In other words, that on the x-axis, here's negative pi, right? Here's pi, there's negative pi. So if I go in between here and here, I see that if I start here at negative pi 0, it goes down, up through 0, 0, up to here, which is pi over 2, 1, and then back down through pi 0, and then it starts repeating. And that also is 2 pi units, right? Between negative pi and pi, well, this is pi units plus another pi unit, so that distance is 2 pi. So visually, you should be able to tell that the period is 2 pi. All right, there's something else we want to talk about, and that's the amplitude. And before going on the definition, basically, if you're looking at the amplitude of the sine function, we're going to talk about amplitudes of only the sine and the cosine function. Saying if you look at the very bottom and the very top, it's half the distance is the amplitude. So it is, how far is it from the bottom to the top? Well, it goes from negative 1 to 1. That's a distance of 2 spaces, and half of that distance is 1. So we would say this has an amplitude of 1. It's a positive number. Some people call the amplitude the height, but then you might think, oh, it's 2 units high. And actually, it means from the center, how high is it? Not from the very bottom to the very top. It's only half that distance. So here is a precise definition. The amplitude of a sine wave, which could also be called the sine function, is the absolute value of half the difference between the maximum and minimum y-coordinates. So if you take the maximum y-coordinate 1 minus a negative 1, right? So if you did 1 minus negative 1, and then you divide it by 2, 2 over 2 is 1. So you can see how that does make sense, that you would get an amplitude of 1. If you wanted to use this precise definition. The other way is you just look through the center here. The center is really the x-axis here, right? And it goes up 1 or it goes down 1. So the amplitude is defined to be 1. All right, so this is your basic, most basic, trig function. Y equals sine x. It's the first one everyone learns how to graph. And you want to get comfortable with this so that if somebody says graph y equals sine x, you can go right to it. It's always, I remember, it always starts at 0, 0. And it ends at 2 pi 0. And it goes up and then down and back to 2 pi. But of course, you could start it over here at negative 2 pi. Go up, down, and ending right here. That would be one period, right? So if somebody asked you to graph one period, maybe somebody's would look, you know, just this part that I'm going to do in red right here, somebody might say, okay, that's one period. Okay, that's true. That's one period. Somebody else might draw their period like this. Okay, I'm going to start here, and I end up here. Okay, that's fine. That's one period as well, because it's 2 pi units on the x-axis. But most people will do this one, starting here and going through here. If I said two periods, you'd have to go again. But you want to get the basic idea of how this goes and do a pretty good rough sketch of it. All right, here's the very important thing to remember. So if you were to graph y equals sine of x, you want to know these five key points. In other words, these five key ordered pairs. 0, 0, pi over 2, 1, pi 0, 3 pi over 2, and 2 3 pi over 2, negative 1, and 2 pi, 0. So if I were going to do this, you first of all want to make sure that you mark on your axis, well, for instance, let's say that this is pi, then we know every other hash mark is going to be pi more, right? Here's negative pi and negative 2 pi. So on the x-axis, you want to be consistent. This is where a lot of people have trouble when they have like pi over 3 and pi over 4, the markings aren't really in the right place on the x-axis. We'll go over that later. And then, of course, we want to be consistent differently on the y-axis. Let's say we're going to go in between negative 1 and 1. So we want to plot these five key points. 0, 0, pi over 2, 1, pi 0, 3 pi over 2, negative 1, and 2 pi. And that will give us one period. So you always want to mark these key points. Now, you can also write the ordered pairs in, but as long as you've labeled what's on the x and y axis, it should be clear what those ordered pairs are. And what makes, and this really keeps going on and on, right? Like we could do some more ordered pairs. For instance, we can do 2. But remember to put arrows, and don't make it look like it goes up forever, necessarily, or down forever. You know it's going to keep going like this. So we could label these ordered pairs, or as long as you're very clear marking on the x and y axis, it should be clear. But what makes them key points is that we sort of have a beginning of a cycle. We have the maximum point of the cycle. That's here at pi over 2, 1 for y equals sine of x. And we have the center of the cycle right here at pi 0. We have the minimum, one of the minimum points of the cycle right here at 3 pi over 2, negative 1, and sort of where it ends. So that's how the five key points are defined. You always want to have at least five key points for a sine function. So you want to remember this. It starts off at 0, 0. Ends up at 2 pi 0, it goes 0, 1, 0, negative 1, 0. That is for y equals sine of x. That's going to help us graph other functions in with the sine, for instance, 2 sine x or negative 5 sine x, etc., which we'll be doing on some of the next few videos. This is your math gal, Julie Harland. Please visit my website at yourmathgal.com, where all of my videos are organized by topic.